Good evening. Welcome to Week 5 Optics. Today we're going to talk a little bit about some optical properties, things that we've alluded to in the past, and go into a little bit more detail about the way that lenses work, but we're not going to go into an excruciating amount of detail. There's a lot of additional things that we're going to be able to touch on, but not go into so much detail that, it gets pretty mathy in this stuff. After a while, and there's just a few things that I think are important takeaways for us to understand, but if you're interested in more research, there's a number of ways that you can find out about each of those things. Most significant, of course, is just to start Googling for some of the terms that we mention today. So just a couple of reminders, of course, problem set 2 is due tonight. Project 2, please, if you haven't looked at it yet, please look at it right now. I promise we will wait 30 seconds for you to look at Project 2. It's a doozy. It's one of the more ambitious projects of the term, except for the final project. So please be sure that you take a look at that and start working on it as soon as possible. You might find yourself a little stuck if you wait until the very last minute. And also, I realize that it's sort of bad timing for those of us here on the East Coast of the United States. There's sort of this impending storm that's coming up for the next week. A lot of the projects that we find might be a little more indoor-focused than usual, and that's okay and unfortunate. We sort of lost the luck of the draw in this case. Problem set 3 was released today. It is very similar in spirit to problem set 2. There's one question at the very end of the problem set where we ask you for your Tumblr username, which is a little bit different than usual, but that's just going to help us later on in the semester associate which of the images that you posted to the blog to you. That will help us out in the long run. So let's talk a little bit about lenses and optics. So unlike a lot of the other topics that we address in class, this is one of the things that really just doesn't change very much. The physics of optics is relatively well known, and we are limited by those properties based on the technology that we can produce for it. Now, it's not to say that there's no more, there's no way that we can continue innovating in that space. In fact, we are seeing a lot of innovation in this as even in the past couple of years. But all I mean to say is that optics are one of the things that do not really change as much as some of the other elements of digital photography. And so for this reason, there's almost a little bit of an investment that you can make in lenses or in glass compared to some of the bodies that you can buy, which because of their behavior as essentially mini computers, they tend to drop in price very rapidly, whereas because lenses have a much longer life cycle, they tend to retain their value for a much longer amount of time. Those of you that have been in photography as hobbyists may already know this, but investing your money, if you have money to spend on photography and you want to try to upgrade your kit, one of the best ways that you can do this in terms of investment, quote unquote, is in fact in the lenses. Now, that's not to say that those lenses will appreciate in value, but they won't depreciate as much as you might expect in a lot of the other elements. It's very common, in fact, that if you put some work into it, you can actually purchase used lenses, use them for a number of years, and if you keep them in good condition, you can sell them almost at the same price that you actually bought them from. And this is extremely true. I did this a couple of times myself. You'll see a couple of the photos today, in fact, with some lenses that I purchased used and then resold once I felt like I no longer had a need for them or my interest had sort of moved beyond what those lenses were capable of. And this is actually great for those of us that are photographers because that means that we can purchase more specialty glass, be able to use it, play with it, see if that really fits our particular style, and later on sell it without too much of a loss on that. It almost feels a little bit like renting. But if you don't want to go into that level of commitment, there are also a number of ways that you can also just rent lenses. So there's a lot of places online in particular, like lensrentals.com and some others that allow you to rent for reasonable prices cameras and lenses and be able to use that in your own photography. In fact, we used to have a store here in Cambridge called Calumet near the Galleria that did this very thing. They had a wide stock of cameras and lenses, and it was great. People would go rent them for a weekend, and they would have a weekend rate. But unfortunately, that store is no more, so we have to rely on online online sites. But those of you that are at a distance might have some camera stores local to yourselves that might also be able to do that as well. So let's come back to this idea of lenses. So we've talked already about some very simple lens diagrams, and we're going to continue to use this a little bit in order to relay some of the more fundamental aspects of lenses that are important to us as photographers. But again, realize that this is a vast oversimplification of what is actually happening or the components that are actually contained within the lens. And so this diagram we used in particular for the discussion of the f-number and how that is a ratio of what two numbers? So they're kind of labeled here already, yes. Right, so f, the focal length, and d, the diameter. And so I did a lot of hand-waving before about what a focal length actually was, but that is essentially the power of the lens. There's two different definitions that we can really look at the focal length, depending on whether the lens itself causes rays to converge or to diverge. But for our purposes as photographers, that we're mostly going to be dealing with lenses that operate in this particular way. And what the focal length essentially means is for a lens, for an object that is at infinity, which for our purposes is just anything that's really far away, it is the distance that the lens is able to focus a ray of light from that source all the way at infinity to an actual point so that it is actually in focus. So this is the most important aspect of focal length. It's just that it's essentially just that power. So longer focal lengths will be able to, it's maybe a little counterintuitive compared to what we would, what we actually see, but longer focal lengths take a longer amount of time to focus that that object at a distance in terms of distance from that lens. But longer focal lengths also translate to sort of a more zoomed in, a more magnified, at least in terms of what we are thinking of as photographers, more magnified image. So again, I want to mention that this is a vast oversimplification. Lenses are much more complicated than that. There are many elements that go inside in order to provide not only this focusing power so that lenses are able to converge rays of light that enter the front of the lens into the sensor at the very back of this of the camera body, but they have to do a variety of other things as well, like actually focus that ray of light. So I mentioned before that the focal length is a measure of when something is at infinity. But if in the end, what the focal length translates to is essentially the field of view, or how much of the scene will actually be captured by this lens and translated and positioned onto the sensor in the back of the camera. So we'll come back to this in just a moment, but there's a couple of things that I want to point out about this, is that there are a lot of complex structures inside of here. So we can have lenses that are able to modify their focal length in some sort of physical way by actually moving portions of lens elements together as a group or in relation in some ratio to each other. They're able to modify their focal length, which is actually a zoom lens. A zoom lens that is able to change its focal length is, in fact, that. It's able to change its field of view or, in some way, its magnification power based on the modifying the distance of some of the groups within the lens. Now, there's this idea of being able to actually modify the focal length in a physical sense through this optical change, by actually optically changing the focal length of the elements inside of this glass lens. And generally speaking, if you want to have zoom, this is what you want, because this preserves the highest possible quality in your photograph. But there is also a different kind of zoom as well, called digital zoom, which is not really an optical property at all and is not really relevant to this lens, but in fact is something that your camera or your smartphone might do. If you zoom in and you're using digital zoom, essentially what it's doing is taking smaller and smaller portions in the middle of the image and just blowing it up to be the same size as the original image. Now, from your experience in using manipulating images on your computer, you probably know that blowing up an image on your computer is not necessarily the best way to preserve the quality of that image. Very quickly will you see artifacts or the blocky pixels as a result of this modification. So generally speaking, we would prefer, in the case that we need zoom, we would prefer to have an optical zoom over a digital zoom. And early digital cameras really futzed with this a little bit. They would say that they had just this incredible magnification power, like 500x or something like that. But it really was a combination of optical zoom, which would maybe have, I don't know, 5x or 10x magnification, modification in terms of its focal length. And then the remaining would actually be covered by the internal CPU that would actually blow up the middle pixels and expand it to be that. So generally speaking, digital zoom is not something that you want to have if you were concerned about preserving the most amount of quality out of your photograph. Now, I dare say that you could probably do a better job trying to blow up your image digitally, if you wanted to do this, later on your computer. So generally speaking, I try not to use digital zoom as much as possible just because of this reason. I want to preserve that original optical quality as much as possible, and then perform the modification later on my computer if necessary. And so any camera that supports digital zoom, I tend to immediately turn it off. Let's come back to this complicated sequence of glass elements inside. There's some other elements in here as well that confer additional features into this lens. And one of them is the ability to actually slightly vibrate or slightly move some of the smaller glass elements in the far right part of this lens to try to compensate for motion blur. This is called optical image stabilization. It's actually using optics to try to stabilize an image, and we'll talk a little bit more about this later on today. So this lens is a Canon lens. It's an EF, looks like 400, f2.8. So it's a pretty long lens in terms of, well, you can sort of see its mass just already, just in this picture. And Shelley took this photo last year as an excellent example of the all of the neat features inside of a lens. Let's come back to this idea of focal length and discussion of how focal length can actually translate to modifying your image. Now, all of you are, I'm sure, familiar with how zooming in on a photo can actually impact that, but we have terminology that can actually describe a little bit more concretely what we are referring to when we're trying to zoom in on some particular object. So if we are zoomed in on something, we would say that we have a long lens or that we have a telephoto lens. These are probably terms that you've heard and we've certainly used in this class. If you're zoomed out, which means that your field of view is larger so you can capture more of the scene in your image than you normally would, it's a wide image. And a normal one is one that approximates with some, there's some play here, the vision of, like our vision. It's not exactly perhaps technically correct to say that because our field of view is actually much different than what a normal, quote unquote, normal lens would actually confer, but it's a close enough approximation. Now, these are, on each of these pictures, there are some measurements indicating the focal length for each of these particular lenses. And they've been converted to a common standard, which is reflective of 35 millimeter or full frame sensor camera. We'll talk a little bit later when we talk about digital sensors about why the size of the sensor is actually relevant for the field of view, but it in fact makes a huge difference. In fact, we'll even allude to it a little bit more today. But just for now, just assume that the numbers that I'm going to tell you are sort of representative of the numbers that you might encounter on your camera, especially in the metadata for your camera. But if you're using a very small camera or a camera phone, the numbers that you use will probably look quite a bit different. So anyway, typically what we define as a normal lens is one that's approximately 50 millimeters or so of focal length. And there's maybe about 20 millimeters or so on either end of that we would still define within the normal range. Anything above that we would call telephoto. So about 80 millimeters and up we would call a telephoto or a long lens. And anything below, anything starting with about 35 or so and below, we would call a wide lens. So on the left, we have a normal lens that's just on the edge. It's at 80 millimeters. On the top right, we have a really long lens. This was an equivalent of 800 millimeters telephoto lens. And in the lower right, there's one that is 14 millimeters, which is, there's even subcategories within all of these, and some people would even call 14 millimeters ultra wide. So I have here a web page. It's actually a pretty interesting way of seeing how the focal length can impact your image. So if you are standing in a particular spot, this is not going to be that big of a surprise to you. As you zoom in, you essentially are magnifying the center portion of an image from a wide view. Here, I'll zoom in a little bit. From a wide view all the way to a zoomed in view. Oh, check out that sound effect. That's pretty great. So here we have 15 millimeters. We can zoom in a bit and see that essentially what we are doing, and in this case, these are different photographs taken with different optical focal lengths rather than a central, or rather than like a digital zoom that actually zooms in on each of these portions of an image. We can see how this image changes in kind and how 1200 millimeters really is, I mean, it's basically a telescope. It's very, very much zoomed in. Now notice that we can also apply a number to how much of our scene is actually in the field of view. And this is essentially measured in degrees in terms of how much out of this entire 360-degree scene that's around me is actually contained within this photograph. Having a field of view of only 2 degrees, as we would get in this ultra, super telephoto 1200 millimeter lens is very, very narrow. It's a very small amount. But it is useful and interesting to talk about this field of view, especially when we need to start talking about sensors and how the sensor sizes can impact what our focal length does to our image. So far, so good, I hope. Any questions on any of this? So we have wide, normal, telephoto, and approximate focal lengths for each of 35 millimeters for wide, 50 millimeters for normal, and 80 or up for telephoto, or maybe even 100 and up. But realize that when I discussed before that lenses can have the ability to manipulate their focal length and change it, that as a zoom lens, there are also many lenses that prevent this from happening, and not prevent in the sense of they have the capability, but it doesn't allow you to do it, but in fact are designed to only support a single focal length, a single field of view. And there's many reasons for this. You can imagine that if we have a complicated lens such as this, that all of a sudden if we have to add the support for other lens elements to be able to increase the focal length range while keeping focus for all of those ranges sharp and making sure that we're able to have a wide aperture along the entire range, it's going to get complicated and it's going to get very heavy with all of the additional glass and all of the additional elements and complexity and mechanization that have to go into such a device. And this is one of the things that we see is that cheaper prime lenses or lenses that don't have the ability to zoom can have these advantages as a result. They are somewhat simpler. They can be smaller as a result. They can generally have a larger aperture. They can be less expensive. And these are great reasons to be able to have a prime lens or just to be able to have that option available to you. You might want, in some cases, a small, compact, relatively inexpensive lens that you can take around with you and be able to take amazing low-light shots. But obviously, the convenience of zoom is not to be understated at the other end. We give away some of these advantages in prime lenses simply for the matter of convenience with zoom lenses. If you've primarily used only zoom lenses in your photographic career, I recommend that you try a prime lens at least once. The simpler internal structure of the lens can also greatly improve the quality compared to zoom lenses that you might use. So there's a lot of wins for having prime lenses. But then again, there's a lot of reasons why having a prime lens can be somewhat limiting. If you have a very long prime lens and your shot just doesn't fit within the narrow field of view, your options are limited to taking a few steps away, basically. And sometimes, depending on the situation, this is not a very practical thing. So convenience versus these other advantages is one of the reasons why we would consider prime lenses over a zoom lens. Let's talk about perspective. So perspective is essentially just the way that the scene is rendered onto the sensor. And there's a lot of caveats here. And in fact, that's not even a very complete explanation. But we have this 3D world where objects exist in a distance away from us. And as we attempt to try to capture that in our image, the lens is responsible for making sure that the light is focused on the sensor and reproduce the world in some sort of accurate way. Now, for normal lenses, this is relatively easy to do. There's a lot of optical reasons for this, but it's a relatively easy thing for normal lenses in terms of their focal length to be able to replicate the perspective that we are used to. And it approximates also the field of view that we might be used to. But perspective is interesting to talk about because it changes really only with the distance. As your distance to something changes, then your perspective of it also changes. So imagine you're standing on some railroad tracks, for example. As you look down those railroad tracks, you see parallel tracks, but eventually they converge to a point. So really, if you wanted to find out what's at the end of those railroad tracks, you have to kind of walk along and try to figure out what it is. But the interesting thing here is also that these tracks do converge. These are parallel tracks, and to our vision, based on our perspective of it, it appears as though they are converging at some far away point. So just believe me for just a moment, and I'll explain more, that perspective only changes with distance. And in fact, as an example, let's use this image. This is a salt and pepper shaker placed on a table with a camera a certain distance away from it. You can notice that this salt and pepper shaker are not actually the same distance away from the camera. One is actually a tile farther away from the other. Now, there's a region of this image that's highlighted in red, because I want you to imagine for just a moment what happens if I take that portion in red and basically just blow it up, just crop it out, blow it up to be the same size. You might be able to imagine what that actually looks like. But imagine now what would happen if, using this same lens, I actually get closer to this salt and pepper shaker. Those two images aren't necessarily going to look the same, and the reason for that is that their distance, when I get closer to it, will appear exaggerated compared to what it is now. So let me show you this in a more concrete fashion. The same image is present in the upper left, and I've taken the center, these are some images that explain this very well, that were from a website called 123DI, but they took these images, cropped out the center portion, blew it up to be the same size, and what you get as the result is the image in the upper right, which looks like that, which is fine. It's probably pretty much what you would have imagined. Now, if you took that same lens and camera combination and just physically moved it forward to try to approximate the same framing of the salt and pepper shaker in this cropped version, but in this now new perspective, we get this image in the lower right, which looks like this. It really looks like this perspective is exaggerated, that this distance is exaggerated a little bit. Now imagine just for a moment that you move that camera back to its original position, and you replace the lens that was initially placed on that camera with another lens that has a higher focal length. And in fact, we select the focal length to again approximate the crop, the framing of the crop in the upper right. So now in this case, look at the difference between the image in the upper right, the crop from our original image, and the image in the lower left, which is just a longer focal length lens for the camera that was in the same position. Notice how the perspective is, in fact, nearly identical. If you were to overlay the two images, there might be some small changes here and there, but really the perspective overall is identical. So we haven't changed our perspective by using a longer focal length. We've just taken the center portion of this image, magnified it optically, and captured that instead. So the major takeaway here is that the perspective only changes with distance, not by changing the lens. And this is important because you might be tempted to always take your photos at a distance using a long focal length lens. That will compress the perspective and it will give it a very specific look. But sometimes that's not the look that you necessarily want. Sometimes you really need to get in there using a wider lens to try to capture the same framing and exaggerate that perspective a fair amount. So a wide lens then and a closer distance would exaggerate that perspective. A longer lens and a farther distance will compress that perspective. Yes? So the comment is that in the lower right, it looks like the angle has changed, that the camera has moved up slightly. And that is, so if you also take a look at the top portion of the salt and pepper shaker, you might notice that it doesn't appear as though it is any flatter or that we have actually looked any higher. But in fact, notice that again, these angles are more exaggerated than they were before. So no longer do we actually see the case that these are perhaps look as parallel. So obviously they're parallel. We can sort of visualize that. But here, due to this wider angle and closer perspective that we have, it actually looks as though these points are, or these lines are more exaggerated in terms of this perspective. So again, imagine the railroad where you could put your head right between the two railroad tracks, for example, and it will look like they are not parallel, but much more exaggerated in their perspective compared to if you were to look at some faraway point of those railroad tracks. So here, and I'm not going to guarantee that the height hasn't changed at least a little bit, but I think that what you are seeing is in fact a result of primarily the perspective change or the change in the distance. Now this is actually a modification of this is a common technique that's used in video. So let me show you this video that I have, and there's a variety of names for it. There's the Hitchcock zoom, the Dolly zoom, but essentially this is a clip from the movie Goodfellas. Now watch what happens as this conversation between these two characters is occurring. What is happening from the behind the scenes perspective is that there is a camera that is placed essentially on railroad tracks or like a little dolly, and it's actually being moved. And as it is being moved, as it is being moved, it is also the focal length is also changing. So it's hard to see as it's actually going on, but allow me to zoom quickly, or rather to scrub quickly from one end of this video to the next. Notice here how the angles are a bit exaggerated, indicating sort of a wide perspective, a wide angle look at this scene. As opposed to as this progresses, the scene appears to flatten a bit. The perspective flattens. So notice the major difference between the beginning over here, the beginning and the end, which looks like that. Notice how the background appears to be flattened up against the foreground, essentially. This is the perspective change that has occurred as a result of moving the camera backwards and zooming in while trying to maintain the same framing. The position of the characters' heads and the position of the table all are relatively the same at the end as they are at the beginning, but the perspective itself has changed as a result of moving the camera and zooming in or zooming out as appropriate. Any questions on this? So this perspective is especially noticeable. You can really exaggerate perspective, especially when you're using extremely wide cameras, or extremely wide lenses, trying to fit a huge field of view into a very narrow rectangle can actually exaggerate even more some of these lines that we would see. So perspective distortion is actually something that we have to contend with. And if you try to take photographs of people in particular or objects that have a recognizable or very distinct shape, then you need to be very careful about correcting for that perspective distortion. I challenge all of you to take the widest lens that you have, whether it's a zoom lens or a prime lens or whatever, put the widest lens that you have, hopefully it's 35 millimeters equivalent or less, and try to take a picture of someone that's standing on the side of the frame. Now, you've probably done this by accident even, but you might notice that all of their proportions seem to be exaggerated. They might have like a really big head and a really small body and then really big feet or something like that. And the reason for this is because of this perspective distortion. And some of the best ways to fix this in terms of using very wide angle lenses is to try to square up as much as possible all of the parallel lines with the parallel lines in the image. And in the case of taking a photograph of people with an extremely wide-angle lens, try to put them as far in the center as possible. This kind of flies in the face of the advice that we were giving very early on in the semester when we said, oh, you really shouldn't center everything because try other compositions and framing to see if it's a little bit more interesting. But sometimes, especially with ultra-wide-angle lenses, you might not get the distortion, or you might get distortion that causes a negative impact on the image as a result. So there's perspective distortion greatly impacts not only people, but also any recognizable shape like a building can have really harsh angles as a result of using a very wide angle lens and getting right up against the base of it. We'll talk about some ways to actually mitigate this in just a moment. But I want to show you a different kind of perspective distortion as well, which is at the opposite end. If you're using extremely long telephoto lenses, you can really mar the impact of distance, or really remove the impact of distance on a photograph. So this is a photograph that's, I mean, it's not particularly exciting, but it represents this point very, very well. And this is from my hometown of El Paso, far in West Texas. And one of those, I mentioned that I bought a lens on Craigslist and later sold it. This was a 300 millimeter prime lens, which was fantastic. It was just the sharpest lens I ever had, and I bought it on Craigslist and later sold it. But this was sort of one of the best images that I got out of it, which really exemplifies this thing well, of this topic well. But unfortunately, I just didn't have a use for it, so eventually I had to get rid of it. But anyway, let's look at this image here. I want to point out something. Notice how we have a bunch of stores and stuff along the lower right here, which is just beyond, apparently, this roof that exists in the very, very close to us. Then there's a road that seems to go up a hill and then kind of bump along to the very far distance where there's, in the very far distance, a collection of trees. So how far do you think it is from this collection of stores here to the far trees? Just throw out some distances. How long? I'm sorry? 2 miles? 2 miles? 1 mile. Anyone think more than 2 miles? Anyone think less than 1 mile? Less than 1 mile, less than 1 mile, okay. All right. So how much more than 2 miles do you think? 5 miles? More? 6 miles? 10 miles? About 10? So the answer is 7. This actually shows 7 miles of distance in one shot. And the reason for it is because of its extreme long length. This was in combination with a 300 millimeter lens. I was also using what's called a a telextender, which actually increases the focal length, the slide amount, and also used it on a crop sensor, which increases, and we'll talk more about the specifics of this later, which also increases the apparent focal length of the lens. So in essence, we're talking about a 672-millimeter lens, which is, I mean, it's way out there in terms of a long lens that you would actually use. And if you actually combine these houses with the that are in the very front, which were about a half mile away or something like that, with the valley, which was in the far distance, this actually extends for much more than that. I think it's something much closer to like the stated 10 miles or estimated 10 miles or something along those lines. But this is basically the main stretch of road down one side of the town of El Paso. And it's kind of interesting to see how far of a distance is then compressed as a result of this perspective distortion using a very, very long lens. It's kind of neat to go onto Google Maps and try to figure out where exactly this was. Okay, it's neat, and I'm going to do it. So here we go. I'm going to go to Google Maps. And this might have to be, let's see how quickly I can do this. So it shows us in Harvard Yard. Okay, but we want to go to El Paso, Texas. All right, so here we go. It looks sort of like this. There's a set of mountains in the middle. I happen to be on the west side of those mountains. Let's see. Now, if I remember where... Okay, so I was up here. Oh, yeah. Way up here. Now, this was Mesa. Wait. Oh, my gosh. Why am I so lost? Okay. So the photo was taken right here. Let's see, can I put a little... Okay, cool. It puts a little thing right there. So the photo... it went away. The photo that was taken right here... Will you put a stupid little pin? Okay. The photo was taken right here, and the top of the houses that we saw were basically about a half mile away. And that major street that we saw is this, North Mesa, which you can see curves around. And it was just at the end of this curve that we actually were able to catch it at the very closest part of this photo. So this right here, where the map is zoomed in on right now, is all of the elements of this photograph that were closest in this photo. So let's go back to this photo and take a look, see if we can find any distinctive things to look for. So some of the closest things seem to be an Arby's and a Discount Tire, and boy, all these companies are getting free advertising from us. But the Arby's, let's see if we can find, Arby's is right there, which is quite a long distance away. So let me show you some other ones. We'll end this rather quickly. There's this major cross street, which is an interstate called I-10, and I-10 is this sort of gray bar along the very middle of the image. And at this point, we're now miles away from where we were taking this photograph. Sort of the last major distinctive portion is this lower valley section with all of the trees. And that also is well visible if we zoom out a little bit. Oh no. If we zoom out just a little bit, it is this area over here, which is, as you can tell, quite a bit of a distance away. So really just kind of a point here is that we can have this high compression of the background against the foreground when we are dealing with high focal lengths, because we are not changing our perspective to it. We are just magnifying the very center portion of our field of view and making it the most important element on screen. Any questions before we move on? Now, a lot of lenses will actually show us this information that we've been talking about. Focal length information and what F-number ranges they actually support are generally printed, especially on digital SLR lenses and mirrorless lenses, or any lens really that has the space to be able to show this information, will generally have it printed on there because it's so handy to know what the focal length range of a lens is, whether or not that lens is prime, which you can tell whether it has a single stated focal length, or a zoom lens will have a range of focal lengths throughout which that lens can actually change its focal length to, and also the maximum aperture that's possible as a result of those different focal lengths. So here are a couple of different lenses that actually show us this information. On the left is a Pentax lens, and it's sort of difficult to see at the very top of the screen, so I'll move it down. But we can see here this convention, 1:4, which is just a different way of saying an F number, which represents the F number of 4, and in parentheses 22. So in this case, this lens is actually telling us not only the maximum aperture of F4, and I'm using the term maximum, not in the numeric sense, because 4 is not greater than 22, but in fact, because it's the biggest aperture. So the maximum aperture here has an F number ratio of F4, and the minimum is F22 at a zoom range of 16 to 45 millimeters. Then there's some specific codes that generally mention something specific about the lens, like what types of sensors the lens is for, the size of the sensors, or any specific coatings, or any specific things that the manufacturer might mention about the lens. But really, we're focusing on the focal length and the F number in this case. But here, notice how we can change our zoom from 16 millimeters, which is, if this were on a 35 millimeter camera, a very wide lens, to approximately a normal range, at a maximum aperture of F4. And what this means is that at every point in that zoom range, this lens is capable of having an aperture of F4, maximum aperture of F4. And generally speaking, this is what we want. We generally want a lens that has a constant maximum aperture, because otherwise it's going to have a variable aperture. And I know that sort of sounds like a little bit of a tautology, like I'm sort of saying, yeah, I mean, if it's not this, then it's this other thing, but I'll explain more about that in just a second. This lens, on the other hand, this Canon zoom lens, which is a little bit more on the right in this slide, is also a zoom lens. It goes from 18 to 55 millimeters, but you can see that it has a variable maximum aperture from 3.5 to 5.6. But notice that what it doesn't say is when this F number starts to change. So 3.5, we can always assume that the first number is going to match the minimum focal length. So for this lens, at 18 millimeters, the maximum aperture that we can achieve is 3.5. If we zoom in all the way and go to a 55 millimeter focal length, this lens will have a maximum aperture of 5.6, which frankly is just not that good. It's pretty crappy. That's a very small maximum aperture. It's not going to be letting in a lot of light, and so it's going to be somewhat dark. And herein lies the problem, in that it could be the case, depending on how this lens is manufactured and engineered, that as soon as we move away from 18, we go to like 20 millimeters or something, all of a sudden the maximum aperture is F4. So it might feel as though we're purchasing a lens that has a pretty good maximum aperture of 3.5, when we realize that really the focal lengths that we tend to use frequently, depending on your style of photography, perhaps might be at the upper end of this lens, and so the maximum aperture that we're using is actually very dark. You might have a lens like this at home. What you might try, especially if you have an SLR, is to zoom out on that lens, set the maximum aperture on your camera, zoom out and look through the viewfinder and see what it looks like. And then close your eyes as you zoom in all the way, and you might be able to tell the difference in the brightness in the viewfinder. Because as we're zooming in, the maximum aperture is decreasing, and so it's letting less light into the viewfinder, and so we actually will not be able to see quite as much light in our scene as a result. And similarly, our camera definitely won't be able to either. So generally, you know what you're getting if you have a lens that has a constant maximum aperture. And that's generally preferred by a lot of people. And there's this general trend that lenses with constant apertures throughout the zoom range are representative of a higher quality lens. I'm sure there's many caveats and counterexamples that we could find that do not do this, that do not follow this particular pattern. But just generally speaking, we might assume that to be the case. Now on the far right, we have a lens that is a zoom lens from 70 to 200, so it's a telephoto zoom lens with a constant maximum aperture of F4. Now, generally speaking, I have loved every 70 to 200 millimeter lens equivalent that I've used on various cameras. This Canon lens was one of my favorites when I had the Canon system. It's, for some reason, they just are able to engineer them in such a way that they are, I don't know, they're great. They're sharp. They have a lot of saturation and color, and they're really, really a joy to use. But I found that to also be the case with other manufacturers as well, is that they generally will have, if you have an interchangeable lens system, some high quality telephoto zoom lens that goes from approximately the range of 70 to approximately the range 200, that is just really, really fantastic. And I recommend that you perhaps rent them if you can, because they are really great lenses. Once you start using, well, here's the problem. As soon as you start using really great lenses, you really don't want to go back to not great lenses, because it really changes the photographs just out of the camera. They have a lot more color, a lot more saturation, a lot more sharpness than you might have believed was possible out of your camera. The lenses have a huge impact on the image quality. It cannot be understated how much that is actually the case. So realize that lenses come in all sizes, in all forms, really. We have some lenses that are so big, as we saw in a prior example of the lens that was sheared in half, and also the lens that's on the far left here, we have some lenses that are so big that their mass is actually more than that of the camera that they are attached to, which means that it no longer really makes sense to attach the camera to the tripod if you have this big lens that's kind of torquing it downwards. And so you actually see big lenses, big telephoto lenses, come with tripod collars that allow you to connect the tripod directly onto the lens, as is the case here, and just have the camera hang off the back end. It sort of feels wrong at first when you do this. You're like, oh God, I have to support my camera, make sure it doesn't fall. But keep in mind that if the lens is heavier than the camera, you're putting less stress on it by doing this. And trust me, if the camera has the capability to change lenses, and it will be strong enough to be able to support its own weight when it's connected to a lens. It's actually a pretty pretty great thing to use a tripod collar when it is available. There's a lot of other things that can be said as well about like the quality of lenses. You might have noticed that there was sort of a distinct change in the quality, or the appearance at least, of even the two Canon lenses that are here. People sort of lust after the red stripe on the Canon lenses, because they tend to be, Canon puts them on their highest quality lenses, and they also put their highest price on those lenses, and they tend to be the best lenses of the lineup. And generally, most lens systems also have a similar system, where there's a wide degree of lenses from very inexpensive to extremely expensive, and there are probably a lot more things than just constant aperture that provide additional quality. It could be the quality of the lens elements themselves. It could be the build quality. Many of the more expensive lenses are built to withstand weather, so they can actually be used in the rain or snowstorms or heavy ice conditions or anything along those lines. And likewise, other many camera bodies, the more expensive ones, are built to withstand a similar thing as well. They might have different properties for their autofocus speed, so the more expensive lenses might have better motors or better engineering that allows them to focus more quickly, and a variety of other things that manufacturers use to try to separate each of these lenses. Any questions on this? All right, let's take a quick 5-minute break, and when we come back, we'll start getting into the meat of this subject. See you in 5. Welcome back, everyone. So, remember how an hour ago we were talking about, it's a great thing to go onto Craigslist and buy some used lenses, and they may not appreciate very much, but it's a good thing to perhaps invest money in glass because that has a high impact on your photography. They generally hold high resale value, so on and so forth. Well, here, this is something. This is a Canon lens. I haven't put it up here yet, but this is a Canon lens that's a super telephoto 1200 millimeter lens. It's very, very big. There is a limited run of it. I think they weigh, I wonder if it's on this page. Unfortunately, it's not. It weighs, I think, the same amount as like a small person. It has its own special tripod and this whole thing. A few years ago, one of these lenses came up for sale on B&H Photo Video for the lovely low price of $120,000, which you can see right here, which is might be the one sort of exception to the rule, where if you'd bought this for, it was still the price of a pretty expensive car, and then later on sold it at some ridiculous markup, you'd be able to get some money out of the sale. Now, this is not the most sort of extreme lens that I've found, with the exception of telescopes, which actually do serve a different purpose. They're always focused at, they may have the ability to focus, but they are generally just some variation of infinity. There was, in fact, other lenses that manufacturers have created over time to try to make things a little bit more, stalkery, is that the right word? To be able to capture photos from as far away as possible. So this is a 5200 millimeter lens, f/14. So it's not very bright, but it's obviously a huge, huge lens. And in fact, if we zoom in a little bit, you see this little thing in the back? That's a full frame 35 millimeter film camera at the time. So that's at the very end. So you can bet that there was a tripod collar on this lens, and you attach that directly to a tripod. But this thing was used for, let's see if we can find out some of the things that they claimed that this was used for. This is the only ultra telephoto lens in the world capable of taking photographs of objects 18 to 32 miles away, which is that's a long way. Having a focal length of 5200 millimeters, Canon mirror lens can obtain 100 times as large an object image as that of a 50 millimeter lens. Okay, that's not as impressive. 18 to 32 miles away is pretty impressive. That would be, 50 kilometers, I think, about 50 kilometers away. So very, very far distance. But another thing that you can notice about this lens, which is pretty humorous, is that in order to sort of point it at the right thing, it also had a littler lens, which still looks pretty big, especially compared to that other camera, to try to focus that. You use it as like a little viewfinder, and then make sure you get the approximate location of where you wanted to point this monster, and before you actually took your photograph. So let's move on, though. There's a couple of other things that I want to show you, and one of them is actually a short movie. Let's watch this. It's cheesy, but it's great.
Requires the subtle control of refractive index and other various optical characteristics. For that purpose, more than 100 types of raw materials are utilized to achieve the optimum proportion and combination for each type of glass. This powder is the raw material used in EF 500mm F4L ISUSM optical lenses. It consists of materials such as quartzite and borax, and soda ash, a submaterial. Impurities such as iron that cause reduced transmittance are removed to the order of parts per million, and each material is precisely measured and placed into the V-shaped mixer. The blended primary raw materials are placed into a platinum or quartz crucible and fused in a furnace under strict temperature and time control. This is molten glass. The glass is poured into a pallet in its ultra-high temperature state and allowed to cool naturally. As the naturally cooled glass is to be cast into a continuous fusion machine, it is crushed into pieces by hand once. To ensure optimum quality, the glass is cast into a continuous fusing machine. The glass is again melted at about 1300 degrees Celsius, mixed and churned, clarified and then homogenized. Having completed this process, the material becomes homogeneous liquid glass free of air bubbles. Poured into the shaping part, the liquid glass is shaped into a sheet. This sheet is gradually cooled to room temperature while traveling on a conveyor belt through a temperature gradient type continuous slow cooling furnace. The sheet glass produced by this process is used as the material for individual lenses. In high quality optical glass production, the fusing and cooling processes are the most important. From each block of cooled glass, a test piece is cut out and both surfaces are polished for inspection. The test piece is then illuminated to check for defects. The glass is transferred to the shaping and pressing process after the quality inspection has been completed. Here, the glass is ground and pressed and formed into lenses. A variety of grinding machines and pressing machines are used depending upon the type of lens. Based on lens diameter, shape, and specific gravity, the necessary volume of glass weight is precisely calculated, and after cutting with a diamond cutter, is adjusted by units of 1/10 of a gram. Large aperture lenses used for EF500mm F4L IS USM are cut by hand using heat. In order to obtain even more precise weights, the cut glass undergoes various grinding processes depending upon its type. The glass is heated further and then formed into shape by pressing. Large aperture lenses used for EF500mm F4L IS USM are pressed by hand using expert techniques. Automated pressing machines are used for small lenses. After going through these processes, the glass materials take on the shape of a lens for the first time. Although having the shape of an almost completed lens, pressed glass at this stage has intense internal thermal stress. To remove this stress, pressed glass is subjected to a process called annealing. First, the pressed glass is heated to 500 degrees Celsius in an electric furnace and then gradually allowed to cool. It is during this process that the internal stress is relieved and the precise adjustments of the refractive index are carried out. due to resultant press marks on its surface, it is still not possible to focus images through the pressed lens after annealing. To remove these marks and to make the surface smooth, the lens is polished during the following lens machining process. Using a curve generator, a super high-speed machine equipped with an artificial diamond grindstone, the surface of the pressed glass is ground until it becomes a curved surface with specified roughness and dimensions. Following rough grinding, the lens is subjected to fine grinding. The surface of the lens is ground with high precision using an artificial diamond pellet platter to attain proper roughness and surface curve. To reduce the time factor and enhance the precision of the polishing step which follows, precision in the order of 1/1000th of a millimeter is required during this step. Using an abrasive sheet-lined platter, lenses are polished until the surface roughness reaches the specified level to the order of a submicron. At the same time, the surface curvature is also precisely adjusted. During this step, the surface of the lens becomes more and more transparent. Both front and back surfaces of pressed glass, initially opaque, are polished to achieve a transparent lens. Following polishing, the precision of the lens surface is checked using laser beams. Based on the status of fringes or lines indicating surface precision, the lenses are determined to be either pass or not. Those that pass inspection are cleaned in an ultrasonic washing machine before being transported to the next stage. The lens periphery is milled to correct decentration in the optical axis. Using a diamond grindstone, the periphery of a polished lens, supported by two bell holders positioned on an axis, is milled to the specified dimension. To prevent light which passes through the lens reflecting back, and to protect the surface, the lens is processed with a special coating of thin film. After receiving a thorough cleaning in the ultrasonic washing machine, the lens is placed into a vacuum evaporator where an evaporation substance is coated on the lens. Firstly, the front unit is assembled. Following a careful cleaning, the lenses are incorporated in the sub-barrel. The fifth lens is the first to be placed, followed by the sixth lens. As the fifth lens is made of fluorite, extremely careful handling is required. As the lenses are directly incorporated deep into the front barrel, a high degree of technical skill is required. Next, the third and fourth lenses are incorporated into the sub-barrel. The first and second lenses are incorporated into the sub-barrel. After each lens has been placed in its respective position within the sub-barrel, they are firmly secured with mounting rings and are fixed by adhesives. The EF 500mm lens is expertly assembled by the hands of skilled technicians. The seventh and eighth lenses, used for focusing, are combined together and incorporated with the back unit into the rear barrel. The rear barrel is then attached to the completed front unit, and the EF 500mm lens begins to take on its final appearance. After focusing and other optical performances are checked, exterior components are attached. Both optical performance and electronic control functions of the completed EF 500mm F4L ISUSM are comprehensively inspected. This is the finished EF 500mm F4L ISUSM.
All right, well, I hope you all enjoyed that riveting video on how to construct an EF 500mm F4L ISUSM lens. But one of the takeaways here is that it's actually interesting to see that many modern lenses are in fact constructed by hand, even though the glass itself may be created by machine. And this is perhaps one of the reasons why lenses to this day remain very expensive, is especially for these higher end lenses, they are rigorously tested at every element. This video was of a Canon lens in particular, and they were really heavy on the marketing speak using the full name just throughout the video. But this actually is a clip from a show called How It's Made. And I was struggling to figure out which one I wanted to show you between that one and a different one, which is actually just a little bit more generic with regard to lenses. And this, in fact, was a television lens in particular. But it's sort of more interesting, I think, to see the still photography lenses, since those are the ones that we work with. But anyway, this is from a show called How It's Made. And they love that sort of passive voice rather than active voice. Like, this was rigorously tested by skilled people and all these sorts of things, and using the marketing speak. And also, they love to put this stuff in like a park and like take a picture of the item that they're trying to demonstrate and put it in a park and move it around. And it's just sort of like a very fun thing to watch if you like to see how sausage is made, you know, if you really want to get to that level of detail. But it's sort of a neat little show as well to just see how these things are actually constructed. But let's come back to some of the topics at hand. In particular, we were talking before about some various optical properties. And one of the things that inevitably comes up is this question of, well, how does this background blur actually occur? And for us to do that, we have to realize something very specific about a sensor. And we're not going to talk in detail about this. We'll come back to it in a little bit later. But really, that a sensor is essentially just made up of pixels, and we are going to talk much more about that. And each pixel is representative of just a little dot that makes up the image on screen. But this is hugely important for why something is in focus when we are using a lens. So just imagine for a moment that we have that simplified view of a lens. It was that single element, it's taking some rays of light, and it's converging those rays to a single point. And that's a good simplification, that's a fine simplification, but also realize that there's a little bit of additional complexity here, that when we are talking about a specific pixel on a sensor, this pixel might be, for our purposes, a point, but it actually does have height and width, which means that it's not actually just an infinitesimally small dot. It does actually have some height and width, and that means that when these rays are being converged, if those rays actually converge within that size of the pixel, then we can essentially consider it focused on that one pixel. So there's really this range. If we have this this lens that's focusing some light like this, some light is coming in, some parallel lines are coming in and are focusing it like this, that we really have a range of light that might be considered in focus. And so we actually have some names for that. We can actually have this region of the image that is actually in focus, and we know that as the depth of field externally, but we can refer to it internally inside of the lens as depth of focus, where the rays beyond, once they converge to a certain point, are now small enough to fit within a single pixel and therefore be described as in focus. But it's not really sufficient for us to describe focus in terms of just a single pixel, because it's much more complicated than that. We also have to take into account how we are viewing the image as well. It might be the case that something that's just ever so slightly out of focus that actually focuses on, let's say, a width of 2 pixels, for example, might be sufficient on a computer display if we're not viewing it at 100%, or on a print, to actually appear to be in focus. So there is this term that comes over from the film days especially, called the circle of confusion. And despite what the name makes it sound like, which immediately might sort of instill fear in the hearts of all of you watching, is that it's not meant to be that confusing, despite what the name says. It's really just meant to be a circle, or really a point, that has a specific diameter that we define as taking all of these various factors into account when we want to define something as being in focus. So it's not just the size of the pixel, but we can think of it as the size of the pixel, if that helps make this idea a little bit more clear. But it also has to take other things into account as well, like what is the size of the destination of this photograph? Is it going to be printed, and if so, at what size? Is it going to be displayed on a screen, and if so, what size? And what is the resolution? What is the sitting distance from that screen? All of these are factors that go into our perception of whether or not a photograph is in focus. And that's really what the circle of confusion is meant to address, is this idea of, is something in focus enough that our perception of it looks as though it is in focus? There's going to be some regions of a scene where the rays of light converge enough onto just some number of pixels. It doesn't even have to be one. It could be some small number like 2 or 3 or even 5 or something along those lines. That if we view that image on screen with the right distance, it's still going to appear to be a sharp in focus point. But as soon as we start trying to take into account our own perception of what elements or what aspect of this image or what regions of the image are in focus or not, that is really when we start talking about this circle of confusion. So if you would like, it's probably okay for you to think about the circle of confusion as being analogous to a pixel in the sensor. But really realize that the actual term itself does take into account other factors beyond that, which include how we actually view the image and whether, depending on all of those factors of how the image is being viewed, whether or not some region of that image is in focus. And this, again, this simplification shown on screen and this simplification shown on the board, which is horrendous, I admit, is just that. It is just the simplification of some point source of light all the way at infinity. So it's sort of like a star, you know, a little star in the night sky. It's just a little point source of light, or it's like a very bright flashlight that's way off in the distance and there's no other light. Those rays that are coming from these items are eventually, as we get far enough away, going to be moving in some sort of parallel fashion, and it's those rays that we are then converging. So all of these simplifications assume things off at an infinite focus or an infinite distance, but it still applies for things that are closer to us as well. So just to be a little bit more concrete about this, this is a slightly different appearance from how we've seen some of the other diagrams. This is a lens where the front element is this lens element in the upper right, and the back is being focused, the light is coming from the upper right and being focused down into the lower left. So within the range, any rays that converge within this circle of confusion, we can consider as being in focus. And therefore that range is the depth of focus internally. So what does this mean in terms of the aperture? Well, imagine that we have a lens that has the capability of varying the size of its aperture, which are things that we've talked about before. If we vary the size of the aperture, the rays that can come in at the extremes will be focused at different sharp angles, at different sharpness, degrees of obliqueness. And as a result, the depth of focus can narrow a little bit. So let's take a look at these two lenses. There's one on top, which has a larger aperture, and there's one on bottom, which has a narrower aperture. Now notice what happens to rays of light that converge from the extreme ends of the aperture on the lens up top. Now this, because of the harsher angle, it actually has a narrower depth of focus for a given circle of confusion. So again, these black lines that are present on both diagrams, on the one on the bottom and the one on the top, are both the same height. They're all the same height, and they are representative of the permissible circle of confusion. And any time the rays converge to some point that's smaller than that, we can consider those rays to be in focus. So as a result of that, with this harsher angle that we can get through this wider aperture, we get a narrower depth of focus. We get regions of the image that beyond which are going to be out of focus, and that is going to happen much more quickly. So this is an exaggerated view of what can happen, of why, when we were talking about F number and how the F number and the aperture more specifically can impact the amount of background blur that we have in an image. This is why, is that when we have a wider aperture, those rays of light are being focused at a harsher, more oblique angle, thereby making the regions of the convergence below that permissible circle of confusion much narrower. So there's a much narrower range that the sensor can be placed in order for something to be in focus. So let me try to explain this a different way. Let's say that in this same diagram that we showed just a second ago, I'm going to assume that the circle of confusion is the same thing as the size of a pixel. And again, that's not necessarily the case. It's a simplification that we can make for now, but it's not necessarily the case that defining the circle of confusion in that way is accurate, because it does take other factors into account. But for now, let's assume that to be the case. Now let's assume that I have a sensor, and I'm trying to take a picture of this point source of light, which is off at infinity. If I have a sensor that's just beyond the depth of focus, my claim is that it is not going to be in focus. And the only way that we would see that is if we were looking at this image at a fully blown up perspective, and we would see, oh yeah, you know what, I can actually see that this point source of light doesn't exist in just one pixel at the very center of my image, but instead it appears to sort of be spilled over to other neighboring pixels as well. So it looks just slightly out of focus because it's just ever so slightly spilling over to some of those other regions. And that's because those rays of light have not converged to fit onto a specific pixel. So if I were to move the sensor, or maybe more accurately, change the focus of my lens such that these rays now actually converge within the plane of the sensor. So if my sensor is placed anywhere within this depth of focus, those rays of light will then be converged enough to fall wholly within one pixel and appear to be completely in focus. Does anyone have any questions on this? The circle of confusion thing gets people every year. Don't worry about the name. It's very hard to sort of dissociate the name, the circle of confusion, from this idea, which is that we have these rays that are being converged, and so long as those are converged enough to fall within a single pixel as opposed to spilling over to neighboring pixels, then we can assume that to be properly in focus. And again, what we are talking about with the light that's coming in from the far upper right is not actually like some huge light. It's not actually just all these rays it's not just a bunch of rays of light from just this enormous light that's off at the distance, but instead it's really just meant to be a single little point of light, like a star that's giving off a lot of light, that because of our distance away from it, all of those rays are now coming into us in this parallel fashion. So keeping this new and this other explanation in mind, imagine what happens if I were to modify the distance of my sensor from each of these lenses. So if I put my sensor just in the very middle area of this depth of focus, it's obviously going to be in focus because the rays have fully converged onto an exact point, and that's obviously within the size of a pixel. But if I were to move the sensor, or again, more accurately, manipulate this distance because I'm changing the focus of my lens, then I'm going to move those rays into or out of focus as appropriate, because no longer are those rays being converged onto that single pixel, but instead are being converged onto neighboring pixels as well. So rather than being just the small point source of light, it might look like a little bit of a hazy circle, or a hazier circle as it goes farther and farther and farther out of focus, because it's now hitting more and more and more pixels on the sensor. So let's think of actually something else that this can impact as well. Imagine that we have an even smaller aperture. As we make the aperture smaller, as we step down the lens to increase the F number, these rays are going to become increasingly parallel. So this is one way that we can get more in focus, obviously, because we're increasing this depth of focus, so more objects will start to become in focus. But also, if we have something like a fleck of dust on our sensor, the more parallel that these rays are, or the less of a harsh angle that these rays are being converged, the more likely it is that we're going to see this dust. So if you actually want to see dust on your sensor very well, just use a lens that can achieve the smallest possible aperture, or even just on any lens that you have on it, just turn, just increase the F number to some really high number, and you might start to notice specks of dust on your sensor more so than you would with these with wider apertures, just because there's sort of an opportunity for the light to, at this oblique angle, converge behind the dust. And the reason for that is that there are, and we'll talk more about this when we're talking about sensors, there's a lot of layers involved in a sensor. And the actual detection part is pretty far away from the top of the sensor itself. And so there's an opportunity for rays of light to converge behind it. So this is really kind of the fundamental reason behind why we have this this background blur, this depth of field that can occur as a result. And this is a picture that's meant to sort of show you what can happen with point sources of light that are being converged at different planes, at different distances away from the lens. So there's some point sources of light, and again, these don't meet the strictest definition of point sources because they do in fact have width and height, but that's fine for our case, we can see that there are some point sources of light which are in focus, and the point sources of light that are farther and farther away essentially have more, like, larger and larger and larger circles representing their out-of-focus areas, because those points are not being converged back into those small number of pixels, but instead are now being converged onto a wider number of pixels and look out of focus. There's something interesting here, isn't there, which is that these point sources of light are circles, but look at the extremes. They don't look quite so circular over here, do they? They look kind of like cat's eyes or elliptical sort of thing. And we'll talk about this. This is actually a result of the lens barrel. It's actually being cut off inside of the lens barrel. We'll talk more about this. I think we'll talk more about this a little bit later. But again, the main point here is that these areas in the background are dispersing into wider and wider areas to make them look further and further out of focus. And actually, this region of light is something that we tend to focus on a lot. And we have a term for it. The bokeh of it refers to the quality of this background blur. It doesn't refer to the presence of it or the quantity, but instead it refers to the quality of the background blur that we have. So generally, we talk about bokeh in terms of its pleasing effects. Some lenses are able to produce out-of-focus regions that are much more pleasing compared to other lenses. And at the extreme, the way that we can see this is with lenses that are atypical, like telescopes. Telescopes typically don't have the same construction as regular lenses, which have a full, transmissive elements of glass throughout the entire body, but instead, telescopes, in an effort to make the focal length even higher, tend to use mirrors on the inside to try to reflect the light more internally so that they can increase the focal length. But as a result, it doesn't really matter in normal photography for telescopes. But when you get out-of-focus regions in a telescope, you actually see those internal mirrors blocking the light, and you get this sort of interesting donut shape as a result. Because now, normally, it is out of focus, but it's being blocked by the center mirror as a result of this out-of-focus area. So these photos on the right are actually, I had a friend who had a telescope, and we wanted to see if it was possible to take photos with his telescope using my camera. So there's fortunately adapters that many telescopes support that allow you to mount the eyepiece of the telescope onto a camera and be able to take photographs, which is pretty cool. And while we were trying to focus this telescope, we saw this donut-shaped region, which arguably is not very pleasing bokeh, I would say. This makes me hungrier more than anything. But once we get it in focus, then we can see the power of this telescope. So while this isn't a $120,000 1200 millimeter Canon lens, this was a 2000 millimeter telescope, which allowed us to take a picture of the Prudential. This is the top floor of the Prudential from across the river. So it has this amazingly high focal length once we actually got it in focus. But anyway, I want to come back to this idea of the bokeh, and let's take a look at some other examples of the quality of background blur as well. So here we have some point sources of light that are kind of, we can see much more easily because they are pieces of metal that are reflecting just a little bit of light. But if you look closely at it, notice that this is also not circular. It has sides, right? It's not actually circular. How many sides does it actually have? Well, we can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, right? 8 sides, 7 or 8 sides or something like that. This is the aperture itself. There is, in all of our lenses, some device that closes down to actually restrict the amount of light coming into the lens. And if those blades, they're just sort of metallic blades that collapse to actually shrink the size, if those blades are not curved, you'll actually be able to count the number of blades that exist inside of this lens. And this is yet another marker and another differentiator between very high quality lenses and not so high quality lenses. They don't put quite as much effort into rounding out the aperture to make this bokeh a little bit more pleasing and instead have an octagonal appearance to this out of focus area. Once you realize this, it might be hard to watch TV because if you're anything like me, you will start counting the blades on all the lenses in out of focus areas when you're like watching TV and you're like, oh, that only has 6 blades? What a crappy lens. So on and so forth. But it's pretty neat to at least notice that and realize that you can get some information about the internals of that lens just by looking at this out of focus area. Now, some of the other aspects of the bokeh that are important to look at are how consistent is the light? Are there any halo effects that exist inside of the light? Is it the case that you have this consistent amount of light and no shadows or dips, and you can actually have quite a bit of variation from lens to lens in the quality of each of these factors? Is there a difference in the color? Is there a difference in the shape of that out-of-focus area? All of these things go into the quality, into the bokeh of a lens. Now, with all of this discussion, we have been focusing on the background blur, the out-of-focus areas of each of these lenses, but sometimes we want to try to eliminate that as much as possible as well. We want to try to get as much of the scene in focus as we possibly can. And basically, the easiest way to do this is to bust out a calculator and calculate for your lens and your sensor something that's called the hyperfocal distance. And what the hyperfocal distance allows you to do is focus your lens on some particular distance, which you've computed as the hyperfocal distance, and everything from half that distance all the way to infinity will be in sharp focus. So it's just a special focus distance given a variety of factors that meet that property, where everything from half that distance all the way to infinity is in focus. And it also happens to be for the focal length and for the sensor that you're using, the longest possible, or the most amount of focus that you can get out of that image. So you don't really necessarily need a fully manual camera in order to be able to do this. You don't actually need to have the capability to have a manual focus control ring, but many cameras do have the ability for you, like say on a smartphone, to tap on a region and select a specific point. Many cameras have the ability for you to define, I want to focus on something precisely 16 feet away or something like that. And that can be useful when you're trying to use the hyperfocal distance. So it has this kind of scary looking formula. The hyperfocal distance is equal to the focal length squared divided by the F number times the minimum circle of confusion diameter. But you don't really need to do this in practice. There are many, many calculators now. When I first started doing this course, we didn't really have smartphones at the time. And so what we would do is we would go to a website and print out huge tables of the hyperfocal distance based on each of these factors, the focal length that I've selected and the F number that I've selected. Or you might download it and carry around your huge 10-pound laptop from the time and then bust it out and set it up and find out exactly what the hyperfocal distance actually was. But nowadays, we don't have to do that. DOFmaster.com is one way that you can find out this information. You know, I realize I forgot to check if that actually still exists. It's been a staple in figuring out the hyperfocal distance for so long that I hope it does actually exist with me saying this. But that is one way that you'll be able to find this. And I'm sure there are apps also for your smartphone where you'd be able to input whatever the settings are for your particular camera and be told what the hyperfocal distance is, and then focus on it either manually using the focus ring on your lens or using some other tactic to try to get your camera to focus on it. You could even have someone or focus or point the camera at something that's approximately that distance away, focus on that, and then recompose to try to capture the hyperfocal distance. But if you happen to have a lens that actually shows focus markings or depth of field markings, then your job has been made much easier. Because essentially, all you have to do for a given F number is put one extreme of that depth of field scale at infinity, and then automatically you will get this hyperfocal distance. We can see that for this lens on the left, there's a color-coded depth of field scale that corresponds to the F numbers printed on the barrel. So if we were set to F16, for example, it's this very light blue color, we can see that that corresponds to the widest depth of field marker on this lens barrel. And by setting that lens focus at the far end of the depth of field to infinity, we can see that the depth of focus, the depth of field is focused centrally on something about 6 meters away, about 15 feet away. And we can see that at about half that, I guess not even six, it's a little bit less than that, at about half that, the depth of field begins all the way to infinity, maximizing the amount of focus that we can get out of this lens for that F number combination. So generally speaking, of course, all of the things that we discussed before apply here as well. We want to use a very high F number in order to maximize the depth of field. We want to use a very low focal length, because as we can see here, if we have a low focal length, we'll be able to get that hyperfocal distance closer to us, and those are going to be good ways to accomplish this. Now, there's a couple of other things that we want to mention as well. Now, it's going to feel a little disjoint, but these are all useful things to be aware of when we're discussing lenses. One of them is this concept of optical image stabilization, something that we talked about briefly before, but there are many different forms of optical image stabilization. One of them is that there are some elements inside of the lens that counteract your movements as you hold a lens. And generally, the lens will do this by detecting movement and trying to counteract that with some small motors that move a very small, one of the smallest elements inside of the lens, just a small amount to try to counteract that. But also, you can have image stabilization that exists in the body of the camera as well. So the sensor itself actually moves. And there's pros and cons to each. One of the pros of having it in the body is that it's built into the body, so you have all of your lenses have optical image stabilization. The downside is that this doesn't work very well for specific lenses. As the focal length changes, it will vary with the quality of the optical image stabilization based on the lens that's actually placed on there. So if we actually have image stabilization inside of individual lenses, that perhaps increases the cost of the individual lens, which is obviously a downside, but that image stabilization can be tuned to the focal lengths that that lens provides, arguably making the image stabilization a little bit higher quality. But obviously there's some generational things that we have to deal with here as well, in that perhaps newer bodies have overall better image stabilization, so on and so forth. All of these things are something to deal with. So generally speaking, we can get 3, 4, maybe even 5 stops of image stabilization. What this means is that if you are able to hold an image still at 1 second, which I guarantee you're not going to be able to, with optical image stabilization, you'd be able to get 3 stops slower than that, or even up to 5 stops slower than that. Which again is not the same thing as 3 times. That's 3 stops. So that's 2 times 2 times 2, which is 8 times slower, which is actually a pretty fantastic thing. One of the things to watch out for is that image stabilization does not always properly detect when it's on a tripod and will still cause a little vibration in the sensor or in the optical element, giving a little bit of blur. But those are probably older technologies that we don't see that much anymore. Hopefully now those are actually a little bit better at detecting when they're on a tripod and disabling that image stabilization when it's not necessary. But one thing that we alluded to also before was this idea of tilt-shift lenses. And we're not going to be able to have time in the last 5 minutes to go into these in detail, but these have essentially 2 different things that you can do to them. You can either tilt the lens so that it's off axis from the sensor, or you can shift the lens so that that lens is no longer centered directly over the sensor like it would normally be. And these help out with a variety of things. They do have sort of that miniaturization technique that we saw as a result of Henry's Project 2 from last year. We showed some photos from his sample lens, which actually could do this, a little bit of a tilt and a little bit of a shift, and he was able to use that to get some interesting miniaturization. But we actually do that. DOFmaster.com is one way that you can a building, for example. Normally you're on the ground, you take a picture of the building is tall, you have to point up to it. Now all of a sudden, all of these lines are converging on a point off the image, and no longer do we have nice parallel lines that exist in this building. But this isn't really how I want to capture this building. It doesn't actually look as impressive as it did in person. So perhaps what I want to do is to try to square up that image and take it such that all of the lines are now perfectly parallel. Now you might be tempted to use the quote-unquote tilt aspect of a tilt shift lens because you might be thinking, oh, okay, well it looks like it's no longer tilted. That's not the case. You want to use the shift. And the reason for that, what you do with a tilt shift lens is you are then able to shift the center portion of that region to a different location on the sensor, which means that in order to take this picture compared to this one, I zoom out a little bit and recompose the image so that it is actually perfectly aligned perpendicular to the face of this building. That means that the bottom portion of this image is just all ground, basically. And I take the picture, and later on, I didn't use the tilt shift lens in this case, I just did it manually, just by doing this manually and then cropping out the bottom portion of the image. But this was just a whole lot of ground in this image. It was half ground, and then the horizon on the center, and then the building was in the top half. But just by cropping it out, are we able to recompose the image in such a way that we preserve the parallel lines and capture the image that we had wanted. But doing it in a tilt-shift lens allows us to do this optically. So we can shift the relative placement of the sensor. Really what we're doing is we're shifting the lens itself off-center so that we are essentially cropping off that bottom portion that we no longer want. It's pretty neat stuff. Unfortunately, tilt-shift lenses are some of the most expensive lenses that you will find in a particular system, and not all systems have them. It's really pretty dedicated hardware that you will find in only a subset of the camera systems that exist. If you have a Canon or Nikon lens, you will almost certainly be able to find tilt-shift lens. But if you're using like a mirrorless or Micro Four Thirds type, it may not be quite so readily available. Anyway, due to a lot of the features that these tilt shift lenses have as well, there's some other downsides, like their full manual control, and you no longer have the ability to autofocus with them. There's a variety of technical reasons for this, but it's still really fun to play with and neat to try this. There's also the tilt aspect, which actually tilts the lens relative to the sensor plane. And effectively, what this means is that no longer do you have this depth of focus that was parallel to the sensor, but you have this depth of focus that's now off parallel from the sensor, which means that you could potentially try to get the entire ground in focus with a relatively low F number because you've changed that plane of focus such that the whole ground leading up to the horizon is in focus. And if you do it the other way, you can actually get the opposite as well. You can get this sort of miniaturization with a tilt-shift lens. It's pretty cool, pretty neat stuff. In the last couple minutes, I also just want to talk briefly about filters. Don't be confused by the shape, or rather the symbol for filter size, which looks very similar to the location of a sensor plane, which was a zero with a vertical line through it. This is more of like a null sign, a zero with a diagonal line to it. And there's many types of filters. Perhaps the most important ones that you'll want to pay attention to, particularly for Project 2, might be neutral density filters, which are, for lack of a better analogy, like sunglasses for your camera. They basically just dim the amount of light, but do so in a better way than sunglasses because they neutrally reduce the intensity of all of the light across the entire spectrum rather than sunglasses, which can provide a tint to the light coming in. We'll talk a little bit more about this, these filters next week, but I at least wanted to bring neutral density to your attention in case you needed to increase the shutter speed, the duration that the shutter is actually open for some reason or another. But anyway, with that, thank you all very much for coming. We will see you next week.